From the chat?
Yes. But they got it right.
Oh.
I said, I can bring some of the water today, of course. There's no water.
They would do something. The city, it always gives this. Had a chance to get back on it.
I threw it on my face.
Two issues thrown in, single issue thrown in my face. Now, the Y was still in the pool if you made 20 points.
Because I said, I'm big deal, I think. This year.
And then, we got the license, so it's. They want. I'm not gonna call this meeting to order, we're gonna do this a little differently. Please, if I can ask. Yes, sir. I'm not calling the meeting to order, because I don't think that it is appropriate that I call these meetings to order. These are individual meetings of committees of the city council. I'm not even on your committee, so I have no particular role here other than to be available as your guest during your meeting to facilitate what you want to do. In other words, the power in these meetings, the agenda and all of that, flows from the committees themselves, which is engendered through the council as a whole. So I'd like for each of you to call your own meetings to order. You'll notice if you saw the way that their meetings are posted, they're posted individually now, not as one meeting, and they just simply, one follows the next, starting with fire. So we'll kind of walk through this, and if it introduces any logistical concern, we'll figure that out. But I think the idea here is to have the committee meetings in series so that it's convenient for everybody to come together, meet one night a week. But I don't think that the idea is for the mayor to run or have some particular authority in the meetings. And with that, Don, your meeting's up first is fire, because you're second on, your chair is second on the list.
Right, but Jeff City sent a representative down to train us, the council, about a year ago or a little more. And they said that committee meetings are actually council meetings.
They are. They're not meetings as a whole. They're parts of they are council meetings, but they're not full council meetings. I don't reside at those meetings.
But if they're full council meetings, then you shouldn't be more.
They're not full council meetings.
Over, but they said it was. They said it's the
I
same.
Think I wasn't at that, but I think what he was talking about was for purposes of the sunshine. It's a public meeting.
But it's not a meeting of the full council. A lot of councilors in Bowling Green conduct kind of what's happening tonight in a single meeting of the whole. In that case, it would look a little different. But these are, we have specific membership to these committees. I'm not on your committee.
Right.
You're the chair of that of the fire committee, for example. So it's your committee to run.
Okay, but the audience can still take.
Yeah, but
participate.
As a legislative meeting, as you see fit.
Okay. The legislative body makes its own rules.
Everybody agree? Before I start the meeting.
Just one part.
Yeah, hold on. I think Tim's been asking.
So, okay. So if there's four members that's on the fire board, there's only two present here right now. No,
you don't have a quorum.
From now on, we need to have a copy of the agenda, because otherwise.
Sure, the agenda is part of the posting, and it's
I know it's the same every month. I know it is, but.
But if your committee, any committee that you're on, I mean, it's your committee.
Yeah.
So your chair can build that agenda how they would like. It needs to be gotten to Sharon in time to be posted.
No, what I meant was so that we know what order we're going in.
Sure.
You know, like fire's always first and then police.
And they are posted and I would expect that this will remain the same. And if you'd like to number your sheet, the way that they are posted, it's, and I just took it straight off of the way we used to go down the roster. It's the fire committee, police committee, streets and alleys, and then buildings and grounds, and then water, and then grant, and then ordinance.
Okay, that's all I need.
So it's the same as it was before.
Yeah.
I just simply think this is a better reflection of the fact that these are your meetings and not mine.
Right, okay.
So Don, I guess we don't, the fire committee doesn't have a quorum, correct?
Right.
So we will go right on to the police.
Okay, so I got a question. We have a guest here that wanted to share something with the council.
With the fire? Well, yeah, we could have.
Can we do that?
I'm sure it's not an official meeting, but.
You asked me to write that up and I'll, you know, do you want to pass it out or do you want to review it first?
You can pass it out. So we'll call this a draft, just so that you can get any comments or feedback.
Sure.
And yeah, we're gonna find to come out in the community. Basically, what he's passing out, I've asked departments to determine for themselves, by department, how it is that they would like to engage council interaction. This goes back to council members not being, not having authority or interrupting, disrupting what's occurring with the activities of the administration. But I also recognize and would like to facilitate the flow of information both ways. So what I've asked for is a policy from each department that describes, if you want to talk to a fireman, how should you go about doing that? And that way there's no surprises. Or if you want to talk to, you know, Renee in the administrative office, you know, I'm going to have, the only policy we've gotten so far is from the fire. But, you know, over the next few months, we'll assemble a policy by department. That way you have access to any information you want. And we won't muck anybody up and irritate anyone.
Clarification.
Yes, sir.
Hypothetical. We have a new fire department. This hypothetical.
Sure.
A new fire truck. Does this mean that a council person can't go ask one of the firemen, how's the new truck performing without an officer present? Now, the council cannot go tell the individual, I want you to do this with that new truck.
Mm-hmm.
No, we can't do that. But I don't think you should be restricted to say, how's the new truck performing? Is it adequate?
I think the way I'd interpret that, and I don't even know if really it's appropriate for us just in this open forum where we're not even in a meeting to talk about it, but to sort of wrap it up, this can go wherever you would like it to go as a council, okay? What I'm trying to do is give you guys a way to access information when you need it and to give department heads the ability to help determine when it becomes interference and to communicate that with you. I think the idea is that legally what we want to do is make sure by state statute we don't run afoul of council interfering with administrative action by producing interference. Okay? That's really, so going and asking a fireman, one person could say, that's not interference, and another person might say, well, you've taken his distraction away, or you know, his attention away from his duties, and so it's interference. So I'm just trying to get some clarification from the department head's point of view, what an appropriate way to go do that would be. Now, you know, I think that there's some sorting out to do to figure that out, but I don't think that right now is the place. Maybe we need a work study, or maybe we can talk. I have it on the agenda for the full council meeting, so we can talk about it there robustly. But this is a good example. Maybe reading this will bring up those questions.
I still have a question on the how this is going to work, because if we don't have a forum, and we're still discussing the business, if we discuss one item, then it shouldn't be over.
Yeah, I probably shouldn't, we probably shouldn't have discussed that.
Okay. I think you could go ahead and open your meeting, that you should have, and through the minutes from the last meeting.
He doesn't have a forum, he can't be.
Okay, forget the minutes, but you should, still should open it up, say we don't have a forum, but you still have discussion, because you're not making any decisions.
Yeah.
You can have discussion.
I don't think you can have the meeting or discussion, we probably shouldn't have discussed any of that, I probably should have said no, but.
Okay, never mind.
If I messed up, my apologies, I hope nobody's caused a problem by that, and we're just getting the information out. So with that, let's do move to what we're supposed to do.
I'm just trying to test some ground rules.
Right.
You know, so if we don't have a forum, and what's going to work now, it needs to be, you know, settled so we can do it in the future, you have a question?
No.
So police committee would be Sunny?
Call the police committee meeting to order. Make a motion that we approve the minutes of our April 7th. Have a motion and a second, all in favor? Motion carried. The detective's car had two broken heads, cracked heads, but they found some heads and it was repaired by the city employees out there, so it's back in use. The sergeant's car that had a battle with a deer, and the deer won, the car is back in operation now. Officer, this, I'm not going to pronounce this right, but Komeninski, Chris Komeninski, whatever, his training is going very well, and very shortly he'll be released to be on his own. Chief Hughes told me that there was no major issues with the prom at the high school recently, and the kids expo, Chief Hughes attended that and was very successful. May the 10th, he'll be helping with a bicycle safety program at the Elks. Safe operation of bicycles. They also have some bicycles, and there'll be a drawing, so some lucky young people will get a free bicycle. Tomorrow, he is meeting with Al Murray at the school to discuss their response plan. You know, this is an ongoing thing. The 15th of this month, Chief Hughes is meeting with Mark Twain Regional Council. He stated to me that the USDA grant, which is up to 35%, the city is eligible for that for a new police car. And we also could be in line for 4.5% financing on a 5-year note through that. And also, Chief Hughes told me that possibly the mayor wants to do this. He could have a 501c3 set up to where we could go outside or like private individual financing where they get tax credits and all. That's just a possibility. Could be looked into. Does anyone else have anything for police?
I have a question from you or Chief Hughes. The individual that I can't pronounce his last name, it starts with a K, that you were talking about.
Komeninski?
Yeah. Went on to hire, could you briefly tell us how that works or tell me how?
It's really, the training all depends on the individual with prior experience in that, how quickly they pick up streets, interact with the community. The probation still lasts 6 months because issues can still arise, but once they're checked off their checklist and their daily observation, and the FTOs have determined with me that he is good to be a solo officer, we put him out there. That doesn't mean they're off probation until that period ends.
So I guess this goes back to their credentials and their experience. Once they're hired, What is your?
People all learn at a different curve, so I can't just give you a blanket answer. It's really dependent on the person, how quickly they pick up our city ordinances, how quickly they, it can also be reflective of what kind of incidents they're actually exposed to and that, and how we see them operate, so.
So you would be, what the term is, graduate somebody earlier than you would the next person?
They can be released sooner from training, or they could go longer, yes.
So there's no time?
No, we base it, all training is really based on the individual, and where we determine whether or not the time comes to an end, and we have to make another decision too.
Okay, thank you.
Tim, you have a question?
I got a question. Was you able to ask the USDA if how long?
Still waiting on the answer on your one where we get the grant without the loan, is that what you were wanting?
Exactly, because I was thinking about, since it's budget time right now, we need to go ahead and appropriate and prepare for, and thought is, we'll hold off until mid-year and see what our finances are there. But let's not forego applying for the grant. We want to find out how long will they hold on to it before, you know, how long can we wait until we reject it if we have to reject it, you know, if the finances aren't there at a mid-year review. Otherwise, I mean, I would recommend that the police board recommend the council to go ahead and appropriate funding for that grant. Maybe it'll fall under grants, but I don't know.
We wait till mid-year, would be in a new grant cycle with them. What time are those released? Those funds are released, I believe she said. I'll go back through it. I don't want to say something without specifically what kind, but I will follow up tomorrow with that.
Because it may not even be a mid-year, it may be October, we may even know something a little bit.
Their funds are very limited on the grant side, so we need to apply as quickly as possible, and it's very competitive, right?
So if we budgeted the appropriations, you would be able to apply for it. Thing is how long will they sit on it without us acting on it?
Yes, sir.
That's what I just wanted to find out.
What amount has to be budgeted for
that? Well, see, it's up to 35%, so until we apply for it and find out, let me get those more specific answers, and I'll follow up with whoever's one of those answers. Try to have that those answers tomorrow. That's
anyone else have anything for police? Rob, do you have anything?
No, sir.
I have adjourned the police committee meeting.
So we would move to streets and alleys.
Call the meeting to order. Make a motion that we check the minutes at the last meeting we did.
Second.
All in favor? I don't have anything further. Does anyone in the audience like to address the
I got a couple things going. One thing, I think that I've been approached by citizens as well, and I also had the same concerns. Something I would like to find out with the streets and alleys is, you know, we're in the time of year now to where some different manual type of jobs can be accomplished, and maybe Bob, you might be able to answer this. But simple things is, do we have an earmarked crew that goes throughout the city, and let's just say sweep up the gutters or sweep up or patching, you know, holes. I know we're doing.
I don't have a plethora of personnel.
Right.
I've got a whopping 5 people.
Right. So I guess mine for understanding purposes is how we utilize those 5 people. I just like to, you know, and I apologize for not speaking to you about this one-on-one, but this is
it's just everything is seasonal, and you pick up and leave off with, whereas we were, you know, trying, we're getting to a point where we've got the umpteen tonnage of chap just about picked up, and then you start getting you know, the spring storms, and you got to clean the drains and everything and that, so it's and then potholes are a continuous.
Have we started doing any cold patching of any of that potholes?
We've done cold patch. We haven't done any hot patch.
Okay.
Because there's any number of spots where the distribution department disturbed the pavement, and those are larger spots, and then they have to be cut, dug out, and patched.
So does the street department then have kind of like a priority list as far as what needs to be done for the week, if they time a lot?
Yeah, it's planned out by bills per week.
I haven't hit them up on, and I just...
Because we don't really have anything hard and fast, it's just when you get into a situation where you get storms or whatever, then you have to adapt and go for it.
I just noticed the other day, because I happened to go to the primary school, like the road there in front of the pool, it's really bad.
Yeah, and that was one that I received a call from Al Murray, and I think Bill went up and did some cold patching.
Okay, I've been up there for about a week, so it's a lot better. Okay. Thank you.
Can I just ask a question? Is there an electronic way for citizens to send in?
Yes.
Okay, there's a dangerous tree?
Yes, yes, it's on the website, and there's a form, and you can direct it to council or the mayor or the police chief or the city administrator. And it also allows a feedback loop as well, so you can go back and see if somebody else has already reported it. You can see comments, you know, if something gets hung up right away.
I had a lady today who came to see me. She's one of your neighbors. She will be contacting you. She lives next to the creek.
Well, I know who you're talking about.
Okay.
Yeah. Barry's sister.
Yeah, she has a little problem.
Okay.
Building and grounds, actually I have nothing to really go off of, except that I do know the cemetery has got their new signs up. I don't know if anyone's seen any of that. But as far as approval of minutes of the last minutes, I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the last meeting.
A second.
Yeah. Motion passed. Okay, other than that, I'll just open it.
Good.
I wanted to ask you about purpose building. Have you heard anything from Jimmy on that?
I have not, and I'll defer that part.
Which
I owe her a phone call, and I'll look into that, and I'll let you know.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, we didn't verify.
Yeah.
No, we didn't verify.
Make sure
it's insured.
Yeah.
Yep. I have two things. One is the license office. We were awarded the contract again. However, they've made some stipulations on ADA accessibility. So in all likelihood, I'm gonna play carpenter for a while and get that done, because we've got to be done by the 18th. And then today, the new pool director for the YMCA said, oh, by the way, we'd like to open up the pool by May 24th. So that's been my annual headache for 6 years, trying to patch it and get it. So those are two things on the agenda that I'll be involved. And as far as one other thing, as far as the tree planting and everything, that is all done out at the industrial park. We now have 350 trees planted on 3 acres of ground with 5 different species of trees that were requested by the Corps. And the only thing that remains left to do on that is to get that 3 acres recorded to the court.
If I can back up to the pool, I would just let you know that there is an agenda item on the full council meeting that will have to do with asking the council to consider, not this year, but in the future, looking at a policy where we would purchase the pool services that we currently provide instead of maintaining.
on Lincoln Park, I had a citizen express concern about there not being any utilities up there, as far as the electric.
I did look at that, and we had had problems in the past where when there were lights, the lights were knocked out.
Is there a way that we can, at least excluding lights, provide some sort of electricity to the pavilion?
Oh, I think that's possible. And, you know, if not necessarily the basketball court, I could see them utilizing electrical services at the pavilion, and that needs some work on it, too. So that's kind of planned for spring and summer.
Because I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but regardless of which pavilion in the town they use, it's the same fee.
Right.
And all of our other pavilions
right.
provide electric and so forth.
The last, and this was done before I got here, but apparently the loop was disconnected. And so if there is a way we can move the loop to go directly to the pavilion and put a pole there, I think that would be ideal.
That's all I have. Motion to adjourn.
We would move to water then.
I call the water committee meeting to order.
No, we need a second.
A second?
No, we just call it.
And I don't have anything. I make a motion that we approve the minutes from the April meeting.
Second.
Motion passes.
You can make.
I don't have any information, so I don't have any less.
Working on the LT2 project, which has to be completed by, we've got an extension until October of 2015. The cartridge study has been approved, so it's just a matter of getting everything put in. So we may have to seek SRF funding on the LT2 project.
Please clarify the acronyms and stuff for us, please.
LT2 is the long-term drinking water enhancement dictate that was put forth by EPA and adopted by all the states. And it basically, what it does is it establishes stricter standards for getting rid of disinfection byproducts such as the cryptosporidium and the trihalomethanes that I've hit you in the past with before. So
those lovely letters that everyone gets.
Oh yeah. So but this should rectify that situation.
What I got next is long. Go ahead. All right. Doing some checking on the water, and Bob's familiar with it, Mayor Meaners over, and I mentioned to a couple of councilmen, and Christina as well. So please correct me if I'm misstating something. I'd like to eventually make a motion out of this to have a special call water committee meeting where we can spend a little bit of time reviewing what I'm getting ready to present right now. What I'm getting ready to present right now is, since 2002, there hasn't been a rate adjustment to wholesale water, okay? Industry standard is to have an annual adjustment to cover costs, and I believe it's also reflected in our ordinance to do such the same.
Okay. This is wholesale water. I just want to be very clear that the news media make sure they understand we're not talking about
this. Is the Pike right. County Water District,
so,
Dave.
So anyway, wholesale water, like I said, the industry standards is to do an annual rate adjustment for such a thing. By comparison, we sell our water at approximately 0.0021 percent of a cent per gallon.
Cubic foot.
Okay, Well, so it's even less than that.
By a seventh.
By a seventh.
7.48.
Doing comparisons, just quite frankly, Cannon Water District is 0.0046 per gallon. Now, cubic foot, there's 7.43 or 46?
48.
48 gallons to a cubic foot. So that kind of tells you where something's not quite right there. I've requested copies of our current contract that we have with Pike County Water District. We do have an amendment that was dated back in 2002 with the rate adjustment. It reflected an original contract of 1976, all right, which we still haven't put our fingers on that yet. With this wholesaling or industrial usage, because I'm going to bring up the term industrial usage again, that we currently have in ordinance, there is a big discrepancy. And I believe Mayor Neener has put that out to all council people what that discrepancy is. So I requested from Christina in the water department, what does it cost us to produce a gallon of water? At the bare minimum, we have to recover our cost for producing a gallon of water. So I'd like to call for a special water committee meeting to really kind of go over the history, where we were, where we are, and where we need to be as far as our wholesaling practices with our water. If nothing else, simple frame of thought is we got to cover our costs. Otherwise, the citizens of Louisiana is subsidizing water that leaves the city limits. No, I think that's right. So I don't know your schedule, but I think it'll probably take about an hour to do it.
Just FYI, far away, they are our largest
purchaser.
Purchaser far and away, so this is a big deal.
Of course, we work study tomorrow.
Throw out one more, you think.
I'm pretty flexible.
Work study is Wednesday.
Yeah, I saw you playing with the dog and the dog. Something a little hard.
Well, I was going to say because I can't make it tomorrow, if that's what it was.
No, I mean, we have a work study Wednesday already. And I can't do the following Wednesday because I know that doesn't mean that you guys can't schedule for that day.
I have Thursday the 8th evening open. I'm just throwing out some dates.
Yeah, I don't have Thursday open.
Okay.
One week's enough.
Yeah.
I don't know that there's
the
huge urgency. We're not going to get this into this budget, so if you need to push it out a few weeks, it seems to be.
Yeah.
That would be fine.
Sweet. This month, I'm just unbelievable.
I've got May 15th. I don't know what anybody else looks like. May 19th if we did it early.
May 19th would be better for me.
May 19th?
That's Monday.
If we could do it, say, 4:30, that would be lovely for me. You say you think it'll be an hour and a half?
Mm-hmm. I'll be
But I will be out of the country.
The 21st through the
26th,
so.
The whole intent of the meeting is kind of, like I said, where we were, where we are, where we need to be, and try to lay some groundwork as far as taking appropriate steps to rectify if there's any significant discrepancies.
And by that point, we could have some answers on a lot of these questions.
Right.
Talk about that.
So we're going to do the 19th?
19th, 4:30.
Okay.
One other item for water, and it may fall under wastewater too. I know, kind of spoke with Bob about some of our purchasing, and I know under ordinance, I'm gonna bring this up under ordinance committee, but specifically now, until any adoption of new ordinance, I request that we bring forward, Bob, you hear me now, and I spoke to you before about it. Any purchasing for any of our chemicals specifically be conducted in a bid specific quotation format that's easily read on a purchase order as far as any comparative quotes were as made. So I'll just throw that there as a recommendation. We already have that in place now. I just, whenever we approve warrants and stuff, I'd like to see that was done. And that's on any of our large purchases, but
since we're specifically, you're making a request of the administration that any chemical purchasing for the wastewater plant be done through a PO and a bid or a bid process?
Right. Yeah, I think the only requirement is that quotations received. I like to see that quotation on a PO, just a comparative quotation.
Yeah, I've got one already for
it's not throwing anything
everything
towards anyone. It's just I just like to be able to see.
And do you do that each year, or how often do you do that? Get comparable quotes?
We kind of do it on an ongoing basis when they call and they say, well, I've got the availability of X number of 5 gallon drums, and I'll sell it to you for $120 a 5 gallon drum, when the other vendor was selling it at $160. So
it's just an ongoing process where you're looking for the best bang for your buck.
Yeah.
Yeah, the big thing that we talked about before, and what I mentioned personally to Bob, was, you know, we budget roughly $180,000 for chemicals. And we can spend chemicals, you know, up to $3,000 at a time, or we can spend up, $6,000 and $8,000 at a time. Either at the beginning of the year, do a one-time bid for X amount of chemicals, just however we talk about per gallon, per pound, per unit, or if we don't do that in the beginning of the year, then that means almost a formal bid process would have to be.
The only difficulty I foresee, Christina can correct me if I'm wrong, is the vendor's cost. And I don't see them committing to a particular price for an entire fiscal year.
But we could look at what we typically use and how we typically purchase it and see if we can bundle that to get a volume situation.
Even quarterly.
Right. So why don't Bob and I, and I'd be glad to put you in a loop, we'll look at what maybe we can do to tighten up the purchasing of chemicals and take advantage of that. There's other things that happen. So for instance, you correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, this, when it floods and the magnitude of the flood has immediate and large impact on the number, very large impact on the how much chemicals we need. So there's a little bit of, this isn't at our discretion, Mother Nature's gonna come along and demand something. So there's some of that that's not exactly a we can plan ahead real well thing, but I'm sure we can do better than we are.
I'm just aware that our current policy probably restricts us $3,000, so that's something to kind of keep in mind.
And you've made this request for large purchases, so are you're speaking to a $3,000 threshold, or are you?
Well,
what's your request?
I'll
if he needs to buy a $5 can or something, I'm not going to bring it to you.
No.
Basically, the way it was done in the past, and Christina can correct me if I'm wrong, you know, say for example, alum, we're $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 at a crack each time we order. But the interpretation has been that if it was a budgeted item, then yes, you could go ahead and spend that money.
Yeah. See, and I'm only one councilman, but I disagree with that. If it's a budgeted item. I mean, it's, there's funds there to be spent, but there's a threshold.
You're talking about two different things.
Yes.
One is, can we spend this money that's already approved? Yes, we can. The other is the policy by which we spend this money. What you're trying to address is the process by which we spend this money. You're asking for it to be a competitive bid process.
Right.
So we're getting the best rate. And I would say that we can, unless Bob disagrees, that if it's a purchase over $3,000, we can ensure that that happens, that if you'd like a copy of the PO or bids.
If it's documented on the PO,
right.
That's the only thing.
Mm-hmm. So can we do that for chemical purchases that are over $3,000? Just make sure we're being competitive and documented, or is that a problem?
I kind of had a meeting with Ricky about this, you know, about shopping around for different chemicals, and he said the problem you run into with like liquid alum and, you know, those kind of chemicals is you don't have a lot of companies that produce and sell liquid alum.
That can be noted.
You know, and so, I mean, we are in the process of, you know, reaching out to try to find as many as we can at this point to try to keep our costs down. But, you know, when, you know, like I said, you know, when you have a little bit of an emergency where you need a little bit more, you need a little more liquid alum, you need a little more carbon, you need whatever, you know, you don't always have the time to, you know.
Maybe a quarterly process would work out better, but what I'm just trying to, whenever we make large purchases, I'd rather see a large purchase than a whole bunch of $2,900 purchases, because there's, you know, that's a loophole. I'm choosing into that, but
Well, when you make more frequent purchases, you're going to have shipping and handling.
Right.
So I understand that perfectly. That's not a problem.
We're going to address some of this in a purchasing policy and ordinance, or an ordinance that directs the purchasing policy. But I will give you I will ask the administration certainly try to tighten this up, keep it competitive, and keep you informed about what that process is on things that are over $3,000, and we'll try to lump things in to as large, you know, single unit purchases as we can. I think that's a reasonable thing for us to put some attention on.
I'm going to put a bad taste in your mouth, but
sorry.
Using the right word, the water that comes out of the disposal plant, how close to being potable, drinkable, is that water?
It has to meet DNR standards. As far as being potable, no.
Potable, is that the right word?
Potable.
Potable.
Yeah, that means drinkable.
But how is it compared to the water coming out of the river that we...
I answered you that.
And we have got, actually, what we spend in chemicals and everything to use the Mississippi as our water source, we could probably damn near drill our own well and provide our own aquifer in the form of a well.
That may be, and we will look at it. It's lower on the list, but it may be that the cost of the chemicals offsets.
Sulfur.
Yes, depending on what we have. Right?
Depends upon where you drill.
No, I spoke with Mr. Meyer down at the wastewater. He said the water that's going out, that we put out, is cleaner than what we're taking in.
Well, that I believe, yeah.
It's cleaner than what we're taking.
There ain't no doubt in my mind.
Disposal or drinking water?
Our water that goes through our treatment facility that goes out in the river is cleaner than what's going into our water treatment.
Okay, that was my question.
Yeah.
Can we utilize that water once we get past the cause of what we're
drinking? Then there again you go.
We are. Well, we are recycling from upriver, yeah.
Yeah. That would have to be up, you have to have an engineer take a look at that.
I mean, that's something, there was a program on TV that put this in my head, and that's something to look at. Because, you know, it's just once we get past that bad taste, and
you'd be
it would be a great savings to the city.
All
I'll run that by Mark Cross and see what he thinks. If that could be a possibility.
Well, all right, we'll bring that to the well. If we just pipe that water back up to the
intake.
Back up to the water.
Well, if we piped it back up to the intake plant and had the intake plant push it in. So,
yeah.
What do you think the population would say to that?
Well, Dave's over there writing
as we speak. We'll find out this week.
It was cheap enough, I think, if it lowered a water bill, I think they would consider it. And it's just a thought.
I want some bottled water.
What yes, kind of water what would you get that?
For the same.
Anything else, Tim?
Yeah, because basically what...
Sorry.
What Ricky and will tell you is by utilizing the Mississippi as our source, therein lies your problem with the disinfection byproducts, because you're having to put so much into it to get it clean, and then you come up with the cryptosporidians and the trihalomethanes.
So we're definitely going to be discussing this further.
Yeah.
Okay, I move to adjourn the water committee meeting. Do you have something else?
No, I was just seconding and voting for it.
I just haven't had time to work on the TRIM grant.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've still got a few weeks on it yet. It won't. I'm going to try and see if I can get it to work.
And then, of course, nobody's followed up on the MLB that TC was working on, the three things that TC was working on.
No.
What about the grant? Looking at the engineer for the city engineer for the tower.
We did the phase one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm waiting to hear on the phase two. His phase one is due next week to DNR.
Okay.
And that would be Miko's report to DNR. Then hopefully we can follow suit with the phase two, which is more or less plans and specifications.
Okay, so we're still a ways out.
Yeah.
Does anybody else have anything?
You know, I was going to ask on the CDBG or however you pronounce it,
mm-hmm.
grant, on the sidewalks. I know pictures were taken. Were they submitted? You know.
No, the other one that we've got is the TEAP grant, that's the
mm-hmm.
traffic assistance grant. It's out by the high school and the middle school, going from.
That's a safety school.
Yeah, so. The engineer is in the process of writing up his report. I met with him last week.
Okay. Well, the one I specifically was talking about was the sidewalks. I know TC had put out and went out and taking pictures.
Yeah.
And was putting something together. Was it for the, am I saying it right, CDBG?
But the problem is the city doesn't own those properties.
Right.
Now, it could be if it's part of the right-of-way. But in order for us to apply for a CDBG, we would have to be the owner.
Now, someone with more history here would have to explain to me, but wasn't the sidewalks put in and the street work that's put in was done under
That was done under the development grant.
Yeah, and it was done using the monies from the that they put into the Eagles and
right.
that Keith Short did.
Yeah, that was the...
That wasn't city.
Because I was thinking on the sidewalk program, you know, where we have the 50-50 match type deal, to whereas, and this is what I understood from TC, saying, well, we do the same thing, but it would be like an 80-20 using the CDBG funding
mm-hmm.
for doing that. I know that process started, I just didn't want to lose traction
right.
on it. Has he passed that on to you?
I haven't seen it, but I'll look for it.
Don?
In the minutes of the last meeting, I'm looking to see what Mayor Dietner mentioned about Mr. Powers resigning and you accepted his resignation. And then the minutes from the ordinance committee said that Mr. Powers was working on two grants. What will happen to those two grants now that he resigned?
I'm working on the TEEP grant. That one's still in the process. I do not know what the second one was.
It's the MLB.
MLB.
Oh, the ML.
Curtis has that.
Yeah, Curtis has that. Curtis Hendrickson has that.
So somebody will be working on those?
Yeah.
That's all I have.
Okay. Can you help? What is the time frame on the West End, all of that work to be done out there with the tower and everything? What is the time frame on that?
The grants is only for the engineering, right?
The grants is just for engineering
for
report.
The specs and all of that.
And plans and specifications. Okay. We would then have to apply for funding to build the actual tower.
So it's a ways out.
Yeah, it's you're looking at 5 years out.
So how much would the engineering cost? What they're doing now,
and I think that the engineering report was $7,000.
So
and that was picked up by DNR. Under the phase one application that I made.
Okay, so as opposed to paying the $7,000 for it ourselves, we're going to wait 5 years to possibly go through this whole process.
Yeah, I'm just throwing that up. Phase two is the next step. You have to go with plans and specifications. Once the plans and specifications are developed, then we would have to put it out for bid and secure funding.
Lori, you'd like a timeline on what the process and plan is to get us a tower out there to solve this
yes.
problem. You're looking for a plan and a timeline.
Yeah, a plan and a timeline that doesn't include 5 years.
Right. So let me get with Bob. Let's get through the budget. Let's get through the budget.
Right.
But I'd like to see a big push that we would build a comprehensive plan and things like this would be included. Along with nice clear timelines, but let me get with Bob and we'll try to timeline this thing out and then we can all be on the same page.
Fantastic.
Somebody have anything?
Okay. Okay. I've done. Thank you. I'd like all the ordinance committee to order and recommend that we approve the minutes from the last meeting. Second. All in favor? I think we have one ordinance before us, which I would suggest that we bring to the full council. And it is an ordinance to update the ordinance books. And it's rather long and lengthy, and I would like to have it posted so we don't have to read it. Three pages.
Do we have time to do that?
If we post it.
You don't have a reason.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion recommend full council after posting. We'll post it tomorrow as soon as possible. Give it one reading for the council.
Yeah, so it just has to be done by title.
By title.
It just has to be posted mm-hmm. along with the agenda. It doesn't have to be tomorrow that it's posted.
Well, exactly.
Yeah, that's something that for general consumption. We also have two other ordinances. My suggestion being they came today, and most of us have not had a chance to go over the and prepare the proposed ordinance that we wait and reintroduce it in 1 month.
Yeah.
I'll second.
Yeah, Chuck, with that being said, I'm by no means am I trying to push this to get it on an agenda next week, so I have absolutely no problem taking however long it takes to get these ordinances passed. But I do want to give the committee and the ears present exactly what these cover, and I do believe everyone has a copy of this. Bottom line, this is for best accounting practices. There's two ordinances. One is for procedures for purchasing and making contracts, and the second one is for rules and regulations for the letting, review, and awarding of purchase or contracts. And I believe you will find some things in there that needs to be adjusted, corrected, and modified. That's why everyone has a copy of it. It does set forth some limits. Whereas, for example, he's talking about the chemical purchases, okay? Now, right now, currently, our bidding practices are located in an employee manual. $3,000 is the threshold that the council has elected in the past by resolution to adopt in the employee manual, and what ordinance is in the code book now also refers to $3,000 as far as city administrator's duties. However, that's $3,000 for everything. Where you will see it in this ordinance, you will see that it's broken down by personal property, $3,250 or $3,000 or $4,000, whatever the council wants. But also, it also gives thresholds for repairs on buildings and light equipment. Let's say a police car breaks down, can't wait 30 days or longer for a formal bid process. So that bid limit would be about $10,500. You can read through this and you can see, you know, how it will apply to our city. But the second ordinance actually talks about the formal bidding process and accounting practices just a little bit as far as documentation, talking about the purchase orders, stuff just vaguely. I believe all this will lead to transparency, is a good term. I'm not saying that anything is wrong, but I'd like to be able to tell a citizen who comes up to me why, when they have a question why, I can tell them exactly how it is, why it is. So I believe both these two ordinances, given due regard or due diligence, will benefit the city, and I'm looking forward to each of the councilmen's input.
Thank you. I admonish the whole council to take a look and compare the existing ordinance and your ordinance. Mm-hmm. See where we have problems. Is there anything else that we need to ask?
When do we get our new ordinance books?
They have to go in first to be updated. So I'm not sure how long that will take. It'll be at least a week.
There was a motion and a second to bring this to next month. So.
It don't make any difference. Yeah.
The first ordinance,
yeah.
We need
call for a vote. Yeah.
Anything else?
Yeah, I got two things. If anyone needs references to what comparable ordinances there are in the books, I hand that for you. I can give it to you if you want it. The other one is section.
Can I ask on that if those came from Animal by any chance, or are they?
No, what I'm talking about
are they charter cities, or are they?
No, what I'm talking about is the ordinance that pertain to purchasing that we currently have.
Okay.
That's what I'm talking about as far as if you want, Mr. Hoffman.
I like those sites.
Mr. Hoffman asked which one to compare what we currently have.
I thought you meant compared to the ordinance you are proposing.
And the only things that I found is section 115 point, I don't know if it's 25 or 025. Then also, that's the duties of city administrator. 115.060 refers to the personnel handbook as far as there being a personnel handbook, but you have to look in the personnel handbook to see what's in there. It's actually on page 57 under L, formal bidding procedures, which the ordinance only refers to producing this, this being produced and accepted is probably done by resolution, not by ordinance. So those are the only two things that I found in city code, our city code, that refers to any type of purchasing or formal bid specifications. But the second thing I had, Mr. Hoffman, was I like the ordinance committee to request information from the city clerk. Section 130.230 on the 1.5% city sales tax, and also 130.240 on the half cent sales tax. In my simple math, that's 2% that the city should be collecting, and we're only collecting 1.5%. I don't think there's any foul play by any means, but I do believe our city ordinance needs to be cleaned up to reflect what's accurately being collected. So, and that's going to require looking at ballot language when those ordinances were enacted. Right now, I think there's a pretty good discrepancy there. So, and city clerk and Mayor Neeter, you're aware of it. I just want to let them, everyone else be aware of it too.
That was a sales tax, right?
Yes.
Any else? If not, I would like to adjourn. Anyone else?
I'd like to go back to building and grounds for just 1 minute. And I forgot to mention that I have been asked by Curtis Love is interested in it's approximately 4.16 acres of the industrial park. It's on the same side as BNSF and everything else, and it would take it to the creek line. But he's also got the power lines, which requires a right-of-way for Ameren. So he's even figured that in. But he did approximately $2,270 worth of work for the city during the winter when a lot of water lines were froze up, and he would be willing to defray that cost if the city would be willing to deed him that 4.16 acres.
And that's for what purpose?
He wants to relocate Love and Sons to the industrial park. He has no interest in fighting any more flooding in the future.
Did you say 1.46 or
no, 4.16.
4.16. If we were to sell that outright to an individual, what would we sell that for?
Well, in the past, we sold BNSF. It was, I don't even know if it was $100. But we were trying to stimulate growth in the industrial. And that's kind of a cornered area. And even though the rest of the industrial park now is a Missouri certified site, I don't think it's going to detract from any further development in the back area where the greater acreage is. This is kind of a landlocked 4.16 acres.
Well, what about his property that he currently is on? Would we have any sort of use for that property?
No, I wouldn't want to even put anything down there.
Well,
I know it's a floodplain. I understand that.
We would. We want nothing on this property.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. No, and I think he's planning on taking it down.
But
that's a trade-off.
I mean, that's something we could.
It just comes to my mind that if he would trade that property, then we would.
Well, the possibility exists he might find someone that's interested in buying it and utilizing it.
And coming to us and saying, we want you to help us protect it.
Not necessarily. It'd be at their own risk. They would have to pay the flood insurance.
No, but you get what I'm trying to say, though.
We have no say so in how he disposes of that property.
Except for that.
Of course not.
Except for that, we're talking about making an exchange or a deal on this.
Right.
Within that
expressing that
I would like to see that all in writing and maybe have a map to show.
Oh, I can do that.
Industrial Park kind of show us where that's at.
Yeah, I can do it. I got a boundary survey.
Can we make far sweeter deals than that in the past?
But I think what Lori's reflecting is that what we'd like to do is mitigate the responsibility the city has in as a whole in development in the floodplain.
Exactly. And also, we don't know what's going to happen a couple of decades from now. We don't know about a flood wall. We don't know all sorts of things that might happen down the road that may make that property more usable than it is now.
I got a plan sitting in my file cabinet that I've had for 6 years on a flood wall.
Great. You have to be optimistic. Where is your optimism, Bob? Come on.
It got put to bed about 6 years ago.
Well, it's time for it to come back to life.
Mr. Hoffman, I don't know if we adjourned the meeting or not, but I do have one item, and I don't know, maybe this might be a request from administration. Job descriptions for city employees, do we need anything in ordinance form saying that those shall be created?
I'm all for it. Let's just get past the budget.
I'm not suggesting.
My intention to get a job description for every employee because that's necessary to tie to annual evaluation that I'm very anxious to get to so that we have a feedback loop. Employees know where they are. We have a paper trail.
So the question then is, would you like the ordinance committee to draft an ordinance pertaining to job descriptions?
I can tell you that I don't feel that's necessary for me to do what I'm going to do. But I don't know what the guy or gal and his team will do 4 years from now. So if you want to put in ordinance, that's fine. But I'm going to proceed with getting job descriptions for every job we have in the city, regardless of whether there's an ordinance or not.
I would say that's probably more administrative. To me, that's not legislative. That's just my opinion.
You're right, but we list all the duties, what administrators shall do.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know. So that's why that's the question. Should we address that administratively, that they will develop job descriptions?
I think it would just be said.
It's all for it. I don't have a problem.
Whatever everybody
wants. And it would be short. It just say administration would be entitled to or shall develop job descriptions.
They said they're planning to do it. Us trust them to do it. See what happens.
I trust them. I trust them. It's not that I don't trust them. It's just like the mayor said, 4 years from now or 6 years from now or whatever else.
On Curtis's proposal, I will mark off the boundary survey to get that to you before next Monday night's meeting.
To be clear on just because it kind of came up here, the council's power to create policy extends to the most finite degree.
Mm-hmm.
You can determine what color pen I'll take notes on with up here.
Mm-hmm.
I hope it's green. But I mean, as an example, you guys get to set the policies that control how this city is run.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the council's job is. In the absence of you having set a policy, the administration can set its own policies to facilitate business. So, if you feel that it's necessary to establish a policy to clarify or ensure a process, then that's the time to act. If it is, you feel comfortable that that's getting done, then it's probably more of a hindrance. It's one more rule and thing that makes this side of this stage a little harder to deal with, but you have the authority to do it. It's not that it's an administrative thing, it's a policy. What would we do? You can do that.
But the mayor's powers are set by statute. The legislature can't enlarge or contract
the
lawful powers.
Right.
But the big gun that the legislature has is appropriations. You say, well, we're not paying for it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's the big gun.
Okay, are we finished? I would like to adjourn this meeting, but afterwards I would like to make a statement. evening, as I came to this meeting, I drove down Georgia Street, and there were two people standing on the side of the street. One of them made the charge that I was coming here drunk. I would like to assure you people in this council and in this room that I have never come to this council drunk. I am dyslexic. 20% of all males in this country are dyslexic. We work around our dyslexic problems by doing all kinds of little things to work around finding the right word, the right number, and that sort of thing. As a result, we sometimes don't come off like a person who is not dyslexic. I very often will give you the wrong word when I really mean something else. I have great difficulty and ask to be removed from the Finance Committee because when I look at a page of numbers, it's like going to a penny arcade. I have never come to this council drunk. I never will. I do not deny drinking. I think 99% of us probably in this room from time to time have a drink, but I have. I was really very, very, very offended. And it's not the first time. When I was first proposed for the Finance Committee, I was in the former mayor's office, and there was another council member there. And after explaining why I did not wish to be on the Finance Committee, the other individual turned to me and said, at least we're not inbred in this town. And I will admit, I have a learning disability. In 1946, when I entered school, there was no program for people like me. I learned little tricks to try to make it possible that I could read. And when I graduated in 1958, there still hadn't been anything. We're just now really starting to take a look at dyslexia. It's not uncommon. Some of the most important people in this country are dyslexic. You just have to understand that we think differently, we see things differently, and what's going on up here is sometimes not what's coming out here. So that's what I have to say.
Would you take the time to explain to the public what you mean by dyslexic? Because I think a lot of people don't understand.
Dyslexic, when you look at things, they're sometimes turned upside down, backwards, sideways, all different ways.
Right.
You know, it's like, playing, what's this thing where you
travel?
Yeah.
Well, thank you. And I'm offended for you if anybody can say that. I've sat by you for many years.
I was very, very one to cry.
Thank you all very, very much.
Well, you
must leave me.
Hey, everybody.